I call this meeting to order. Let's do an official roll call. Steve Bacon. Rachel Finch. Pam Lewis. I see Pam. She's muted.
She's muted, but she's here.
There we go.
Morning, Pam.
Good morning, sir.
Mary Pierce is absent. Bob Ravenar.
I'm here.
Megan.
Here.
And Rich Buckner's here. Okay, resolution. I will entertain a motion to approve resolution 2020-131, a resolution declaring that the Civil War Historical Commission shall meet on July 28, 2020 and conduct its essential business by electronic means rather than being required to gather a quorum of the meeting of the members physically present in the same location because it is necessary to protect the health, safety, and welfare of Tennesseans in light of the COVID-19 outbreak.
So moved.
So moved.
Bob.
Hero, second.
Second, Pam.
Thank you. I'll take a vote on that. Steve Bacon, not present. Rachel, not present. Pam.
Yes.
Mary, not present. Bob.
Yes.
Megan.
Yes.
And Rich, yes. Announcement for limited public access. Due to the COVID-19 outbreak, this meeting will be a virtual meeting. The public may call 615-550-8434 to listen to the meeting and make comments during the public comment period. The public may also email comments to planningintake@franklintennesseegov.gov to read aloud during the meeting. Emailed comments will be accepted until the 1 hour prior to the meeting. The meeting video will be available for the public viewing 24 hours following the meeting on the City of Franklin's YouTube account. Do we have any questions from anyone that were emailed?
We have no emails and no public comments on the line.
Okay. Those formalities out of the way, we can start our meeting. We have a number of things we Megan and I talked about in preparation for this meeting, and we had a couple of things we wanted to talk about before we got into the meat of the meeting. Let me say that both Amanda and I were extremely impressed with the last meeting. Not only because every meeting has been impressive, because I think everybody has been very forthcoming in their thoughts and everything else. But the last meeting, it seemed like we turned a corner in the fact that we started questioning things, and it wasn't just, yeah, that type of thing. And that was really encouraging. And we both want everyone to feel empowered to really question things as we go through this. I think we are on the verge of creating something that will be really good for the city here. And this subcommittee is to be commended for really being just really hardworking with this. I mean, every other subcommittee's meeting every other month. We've met monthly, almost every month, and we've been steadfast in what we're doing. And I think it's really a credit to all of you in what we progress to. And with all of that, we Amanda and I thought we ought to take the first part of this meeting and kind of revisit some things that we have been talking about before we get back into the routes and that type of thing. So I know Amanda has talked to City Engineering as she promised after the last meeting. And so Amanda, I'm going to turn it over to you to talk about what you learned from the city.
Sure, thank you. Well, I appreciate that introduction. I agree with with Rich that, you know, everyone has been doing a fantastic job, and this has been a wonderful subcommittee to work with. So thank you all very much. The meeting that Kelly and I had with Adam Mosier, who is our traffic engineer here at the city, was really helpful in this discovering some of the items that we need to address as we move forward. There were a lot of questions that were specific to the map that we discussed at the last meeting, and I'll perhaps kind of cover those as we get into that discussion. But some of the general takeaways that I found were that it's really important for us to probably entertain the engineering department earlier rather than later in the process. I can understand how it would be seemingly helpful to gather all the questions that we have over the course of time and then present them to someone all at once, and so we're able to provide them with everything we need. But in the meaning the spirit of trying to ensure that we are all communicating well as a team, as opposed to working individually, planning and then engineering, I think it would be best suited as, you know, incrementally we engage with engineering to say, is this going okay? Are we, you know, proposing these in meaningful and appropriate locations as we go along, as opposed to piling that all at once, because we want the engineers' feedback and we want it to be valued and integrated as we go along. That way, we're actually, as a subcommittee, not, you know, moving forward, you know, perpetuating some of the, you know, meaningful ideas that we have that may be problematic from other perspectives. So I think that some of those takeaways specifically were the Christmas tree type signs, and I'll show that to you if I can share the screen. Rich made a wonderful wayfinding sign catalog, so I hope all you were able to look at that. But I have the screen pulled up, and I'm going to show you an example of what we would refer to as a Christmas tree type sign. It would be sign I here on the screen. As you can see, it kind of goes up and up, and it's smaller at the top and bigger at the bottom. Now, that's a little colloquial, but ultimately these are the types of signs that provide route information for the state. We cannot propose or continue to add these type of signs to those existing signs. So we need to start thinking ahead about, you know, at these meaningful locations, which are obviously meaningful because they are junctions for major routes. As we are going to place signs or propose the placement of signs there, we need to plan ahead to put those signs further ahead of where these are. That is one of the takeaways. Another was that, you know, there's not a lot of concern specifically about placement of signs in, you know, more congested locations per se. I think that what we're doing is enhancing, you know, citizen and visitor experience by providing a sort of reassurance that they're going in the right direction, or providing them information on things that they weren't sure existed. Hey, I came here to go to the Carter House, but I had no idea that the Lotz House was across the street. I learned that on these wayfinding signs. So that could be really, really helpful for people, even citizens who may not know that resource is there as a place where you can learn historic information about our community. So Google and Waze and other applications on phones that help folks go where they need to go will probably still be the most used means by which folks will travel, but it's still okay that we put these signs in places because of that. I hope that's kind of a long-winded statement, and maybe Kelly Danifelser can help clarify that a little bit, but I think everyone might understand what I'm trying to say. Okay, the other issue that has arisen is just the continued use of signs that are meaningful for folks to recognize, you know, nationally, like the use of a brown or a brown tone type sign to get people's attention for recognizing that these are historic sites. So we need to continue to do that. And as we work toward continuing to refresh ourselves on our goals and our objectives as part of those goals, that brown is considered, you know, the national symbol for a historic location. So if we're considering adding more and more information to those signs, we need to be careful about whether or not those places are relaying a false perception of whether or not those places are historic sites or not. So I hope that will help frame the discussion that Rich is going to move forward with.
Right? Okay. Thank you, Amanda. Let me, a little housekeeping. We just have a quorum. There's seven members on the committee, and we've got four here. And so if somebody has to leave, please notify us, because we got to figure out how we're going to end the meeting, because we can't technically end the meeting with less than a quorum. So
or just continue to have the meeting.
Yeah. Well, whatever, but please, if you have to leave, just let us know. the next thing we wanted to talk about was kind of rediscuss our mission. And some of this goes back to exactly what Amanda heard from engineering, in that we have talked about developing a sign or a program that had a sign that had a certain type of look to it, a size, a shape, and that type of thing, so that people would notice the sign and see it as Franklin's historic sign and that type of thing. Certainly the color comes into play with that as well. And so in the last few meetings we've had, and I think it's a very good conversation, so I'm not trying to dissuade the conversation, but both Amanda and I have noticed we've talked about, we certainly have our historic sites, you know, the Carter House, Carnton, Lotes, Fort Granger, Winstead Hill, the Temple, Macklemore, and then we've added the Visitor Center and the cemeteries to that. And I think those all still fit in the parameter of historic sites, with the exception of the Visitor Center, but that's the Visitor Center, and we weren't adding that as a sign in the sign. We were talking about adding that as a supplement to the sign. We had other historic sites, though, that have come forward and talked about, and that was like, we talked about some historic homes that were not necessarily, that weren't open to the public. And how would they be addressed in specifically the downtown core and possibly elsewhere, like Pam's house and that type of thing. We do have the Forward Line, and we do have Collins Farm that we've not talked about. We've briefly mentioned it as we've passed those areas and that type of thing. Then we have other sites that we've talked about, and that's like City Hall, the courthouse, the library. Those have all been discussed recently as should we add those to our signs and that type of thing. And the last thing is one of the aldermen wants to have restrooms put on the signs. And the question that I had for the committee was more along the lines of revisiting our mission and what are we trying to guide people to make sure that we're all together and unified and how we're approaching directions to a certain location. What are those locations? I'm not saying that we're only doing historic or we're not doing historic and that type of thing, but I think it's important for us at this milestone in our work to kind of revisit once again exactly what we're directing or guiding people to visit in that. So I wanted to open the floor for discussion on that. There's no bad answer. There's no right answer, wrong answer here. It's just I want to make sure that we're all working on the same wavelength. So, any comments?
Hey, it's Bob.
Yes, sir.
You know, I think we can't ignore what people are going to be interested in seeing. I think the question is, and it's maybe go back to engineering. If the brown signs or brown tinted signs are going to only be for historic, it sounds like you can't put any of those other things on it. And if that's the case, I think it's a little, it would be working in parallel paths instead of together if we don't think of those things, at least with a direction of where they need to go. So as an example, public restrooms, while that may not go on a brown sign, it's a legitimate question about people are going to be interested in knowing where that's going to go and who handles that, so that we're not, because if you go back to the signs, you know, you don't want to have three separate signs in the same vicinity if they could be on one or two. And so, you know, maybe the premise is, because I would agree, you know, we're the Civil War Historical Commission, so are we really responsible for public restrooms? Probably not, but that's a legitimate need. And how do we ensure that we're not duplicating efforts or missing something as we're moving through? Because I would guess our work here is probably the most extensive work related to signs that may be going on right now, but we can't ignore that there'll be other things. So how do we ensure that those don't get missed or we're not duplicating efforts?
This is Pam.
Said.
Hello?
Yes.
Can you hear me? I had a thought. So for example, with regards to restrooms, there's restrooms at the visitor center, there's a restroom at Winston Hill, there's restrooms at Fort Granger. If you are indicating those sites, and there's more, what if, for example, you just put next to, for example, the visitor center, just a small logo for restroom that indicates restroom. So the people know, oh, I can go and go to the restroom there. And there could be another sign separate potentially that indicates restrooms. But most people know if you go to a visitor center, they're going to be able to direct you to a restroom. But also, if, for example, they're driving around and they get to Winstead Hill, oh, I can use a restroom here. There's a place here. And that would, you wouldn't have to duplicate it, but you'd be indicating on the actual sign just a little small logo that is the sort of the universal symbol for restroom. The other thought that I had vis-a-vis signage, and again, it could be something really small, and maybe we don't want to do this, but apropos to what you said earlier, Rick, about other sites, is people are interested, I think, to know where the field hospitals were. And we had 44 field hospitals that are still standing. And perhaps there could be some sort of key that people could know where to look for those houses. And there could be some designation on the house or near the house that people could drive by and go, oh, okay, well, Clouston Hall was a field hospital, or Presbyterian Church, or Harrison House, or whatever. Again, I think the reason I'm saying that is I don't think people realize who come here the how small the population was for the city of Franklin and how massive the casualties were, and to sort of envision that. It was like all hands on deck, basically. It was our Armageddon that day. But that may be more than we want. You know, that may be more than we want to go and dig. But if people are driving around, I mean, I'd love to know, oh, that was a field hospital? Oh, my God, I didn't know that. I mean, we put the flags up in November, but that's just once a year.
I think that's a great point. And I think it leads me to say that, you know, we do want these to be as comprehensive as we can make them, to Bob's point and to Pam's. It's nice to try to include everything that we want to show our community and our peers through this one process. But because of limitations with, you know, vehicular traffic, what one person can register while they're driving at certain speeds, which we'll probably cover here in the next couple of things that I'm working with Rich to figure out that timing. Want to make sure we have the most pertinent information, because we're not going to be able to include it all. And we can use our fellow subcommittees to help with some of this information as well. So some of you are familiar with the wayfinding. The public outreach and interpretation subcommittees. The public outreach and interpretation subcommittees major project right now, which is updating the historic park's audio tours. Perhaps to Pam's point, there could be an audio tour that addresses where all the field hospitals are located. It would be very difficult for us to sign it on wayfinding signs as well, because there are some number of those, and a lot of them are in areas that would lend themselves to more of a walking tour as opposed to perhaps a driving tour.
That's a good point, Amanda.
And we can also think about wayfinding in different ways. Rich and I are still working through some of the process, but there are ways that we can involve our partners here in the community, like Downtown Franklin Association. Megan contacted me and made a very good recommendation that we engage with the DFA to see how we can partner to ensure that wayfinding is serving multiple means downtown. With our mission in mind, perhaps we can work with DFA to update their freestanding signs, which would be more pedestrian friendly, to address some of the issues that have been brought forward today, like where public restrooms are, where some of the field hospitals are, or introduce more as opposed to trying to include those all in vehicular signs.
I like that idea.
Hey Amanda, I know it was quite a while ago that we had talked about, or it seems quite a while ago that we talked about different historic buildings, landmarks as primary and ancillary. And I know that we kind of wanted to do away with that language, but in trying to figure out really like kind of coming back to our core mission, like as Bob said, I thought he made a really good point, is remembering that we're the Civil War Historical Commission and, we're kind of focused more on that. Would it be at all helpful if we kind of just went back to not went back to the drawing board, but to start over, but to make a list or to write up a list of some of those primary and ancillary locations, just so that we could kind of have a path to go off of, I guess, as we're determining what signage we need in order to point the visitor in the right direction versus the signage that may just be, again, I don't want to use the term ancillary, but may be more just, I guess, directional for the sake of, pointing them in the right direction. Would that be helpful if we created some type of list that we could at least work off of?
I'd love to hear from you guys. What do you think about that?
I think that makes sense. It's almost like a parking lot spot of, hey, these are things that we think are necessary, and then we don't lose the thoughts, and then we can determine which are within our purview versus someone else needs to cover. And to the extent it would be coordinated or need to be coordinated or planned for the future, we could know who would be responsible for that. So I think that's a good idea.
Pam, Rich, what do you guys think?
I agree wholeheartedly. I think that it just helps us kind of summarize where we're going and what we've done. Pam?
I think the conversation is good. And I think what we need to do is blue sky it right now and look at all the things that need to be addressed. And then, as you said earlier, we can compartmentalize it to other committees, but this has been taking for many, many years now. Let's do it right. And let's think it through. And so that we don't have to do this anytime soon again, let's make it as, I guess what I'm trying to say, as comprehensive as possible, and make it easy for the CVB to do their job too. So the more that we can direct people, the less that Ellie's folks are having to sort of deal with mundane questions too. They can deal with the big stuff. And it shouldn't be a mystery when people come into town how to get around and where to park and whatnot. So,
well, and that's okay if we get those mundane questions. That's why we're there, and we're happy to help in any way that we can, even if it is for a restroom.
Yeah, those are important functions for your folks.
One thing I've studied.
Coming and visiting our community, certainly, yeah.
I've studied all the signs in the historic core now.
He really has.
One of the things that stands out more than anything else is that we only direct people to three locations, really two locations, and that's Carter House and Carnton. And then there was a little side project, obviously, about Fort Granger. and Lotes House got added to a lot of signs because it's across the street from Carter House.
And it's important.
And if you look at our signage, it's very obvious how it was added over the years, and it's in that direction. And we are looking at a much more thorough and much more comprehensive way of approaching, 10 sites and that type of thing. And you'll start to see this in as we deal with the maps today, because we've added a couple maps, and you start to see that there are certain points in town. There are three critical areas in town. And one is the square, because we, I think rightfully so, have decided that we're going to direct people to the square and then go from there and radiate out from there, as opposed to pairing off before that. But then you quickly get to Five Points, and Five Points becomes a very critical intersection. And then obviously the span of Columbia Avenue between Folks and Claiborne in front of the Carter House and Lotes House is a very critical piece of real estate, road real estate as well, with signage and that. But those three areas are the critical areas in town. And that's not only just to get to Carter House and Carnton and those sites, but to get to the Macklemore House, to get to, every site that we're dealing with in town. You know, those three intersections, everybody crosses at one time or another. And so we've got it's really interesting how it's all piecing together. But I think to have that list that Megan suggested, I think is really good, because there's a lot of other sites that we may want to have somebody work from and that type of thing. And we don't want to miss them. I agree with Pam. You know, let's do this and let's do it right one time. We're doing a thorough and comprehensive job on, I guess those are the same meanings, but we're doing a thorough job of analyzing all of this. Let's do it right. So I appreciate it.
Well, and I know, like with Hard Bargain and Natchez, there's a project underway that I'm working with Thelma on, which I'll fill you in, Amanda, where there's going to be more sites designated in that area too. And so people may be interested in African American history and may want to go over there, go to the Macklemore House. And I think that's going to become more prominent as the years go on. So think through it now, maybe, you know.
As best we can, sure.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Any other comments? Do we want to work on a list first?
Well, so the only other comment I would make is we need to be careful what we wish for here, because I do think there's that balance between we can keep coming up with possibilities for a long time, but then at some point you got to get down to action. And so striking the balance between what's going to get in place over what period of time versus we're talking about this stuff 3 years from now and nothing's been changed. And so I think we just need to make sure, whether it's as simple as here's this item and it's either in our purview or out of our purview. And if it's out, you put it on a list and figure out who's going to do it. And then there's ultimately, okay, let's get into the action mode and what are we actually going to put in place so that we're not just constantly talking about it down the road. So that's just the watch out from my end.
Okay. Well, shall we continue on, and then what Amanda and I'll do is kind of work on a list as we go, and I guess we can all do that. I mean, certainly the sites that we are focused on, you know, the big two are Carter House and Carnton. And then we have the Lotz House, which is in the vicinity of the Carter House. And then we have Fort Granger and Winstead Hill. We have the Temple and the Macklemore House. And then we've talked about the just one designation for the historic cemeteries. And that's the base list. And then we've got the visitor center, which is much like what Pam said and I think that's right, Pam, on the logo, with the bathrooms, is that it is a logo that we will somehow incorporate into the sign or add as a separate small sign below the wayfinding sign for the visitor center.
I think it's important to note the visitor center can, by all means, be on any round-tented sign and not cause confusion, in my opinion. I think people expect that to be a place that is a resource for them to find social, cultural, historical information. So please don't take my comments earlier as dismissing the need to add those. I wholeheartedly agree that we need a visitor center on any of those signs with our major, you know, locations that we have on the periphery of town that pull people into downtown.
Well, to speak to the comment earlier, when do we realistically think that we can flush all this out and actually start installation? Is it not going to be obviously till next year? Is that what we're looking at, Amanda?
Well, I can't speak for the budget, but I can say that we've had a lot of societal changes over this year, so it's hard to say.
Really? I hadn't noticed.
I don't know. I don't know if you noticed, but no, I know that's a silly statement to make, but I say that all in all seriousness that, we need to be mindful. This might be more incremental than we hoped when we started this a year or so ago.
Okay.
Because of, just budgetary changes, nationally. So it would be important to keep in mind that we might have to adjust our schedule accordingly, but the plan in working with Rich is that he seeks to work with everyone to try to have a good solid plan together by the end of this year, I believe, in terms of where all new signs and existing signs would be added or updated, and we can work through some of the following details throughout the beginning of next year.
Okay.
Once we finish those details, we'd like to bring something to work session.
Okay.
And honestly, 2 months ago, I was concerned about our timeline. But as I've studied the historic core more and spent time with it, I think we'll move through the historic core faster than I was thinking we would. Because the roads all get pretty interrelated as you get inside. And you'll see later in the meeting that when we're talking about Lewisburg and we're talking about Columbia and even Highway 96, we're talking about the same roads. And so that's why we've added the maps for today, because you can't really kind of talk about one route without talking about the other routes. And so I think the historic core, and I didn't think this until the last couple of weeks, when I really spent some time studying it after the last meeting, I felt so invigorated about what we were doing. And I started studying it. I really think that we will get through the historic core quicker than I thought, because we're approaching August and we don't really do anything in December. And so, we don't have a lot of months left this year, but I think we will get through most of it this year still.
And then we can work through some considerations with what do these signs look like, you know, working with our team at the city, our resources with our engineering staff, our sign in the streets department to determine, you know, what is feasible. We don't want to bring a full-fledged plan in terms of what they look like necessarily to the bump, but have an idea of what we can achieve in-house, if that's what the expectation of the subcommittee is. And keep in mind, too, this list will be, of course, vetted by your peers in the full commission setting. So everything we do, we want to make sure that we demonstrate that we've spent a lot of time researching and relaying and being able to answer questions for folks who haven't been as invested in this project as we have. It's like when you're writing, you start reading what you want it to say rather than what it might actually say. So having that extra step between here and BOMA is going to be really helpful for us too, to work out any sort of issues that we're just missing for some reason.
I will say that Amanda and Pam, I think, will vouch for me that when we took this to BOMA, just a preliminary run last year or early this year, they were extremely interested in the wayfinding program. Mm-hmm. There was a lot of interest. There was a lot of conversation in that brief meeting we had with them at a work session about what we were doing and that type of thing. So there's a lot of support for what we're doing.
Absolutely. This is really important stuff. This is not sort of a thing apart. You guys have been doing such an excellent job.
And to emphasize that, let's move on with the agenda if everybody's okay. Is everybody okay with that?
Yes, please.
I do have one question. Would you like to start trying to address Megan's question in terms of, you know, defining, you know, locations that are on signs that are kind of outside the core, and then, which we've already done. And then I think what we're kind of getting at is, you know, making a more thorough list of what we'd like to sign or potentially sign to vet with our full commission for the actual inside MacHatcher core. Is that kind of what I'm hearing from everyone that I understand? We start moving forward on outside of the Zoom setting.
Yeah, I mean, that's what I was thinking. And also just to kind of focus in on a list that, I guess just paring down our list and making sure that we're maintaining the focus that we need to, and not necessarily throwing up signs for every single, you know, historic location that we have. I think a lot of our larger historic, not larger isn't the right word, you know, those more popular ones like Carnton and Carter, Lotes House, I think those are really important. And I think all of the historic locations we have inside that MacHatcher location are equally important. But I think those larger ones, they definitely lead visitors to other historic locations throughout downtown Franklin and beyond. So I think just kind of keeping that in mind, making sure that we're adding signage that makes sense, I guess. Mm-hmm. Does that make sense?
Oh, it does. It does. Okay. And it's leveraging existing and prior marketing endeavors. That's all it really is, essentially. You know, those are very popular locations because they've been very marketed. Now we can use that to help draw people in to learn more about these just as equally important locations, and they'll become, you know, just as well known too, hopefully.
Thank you. You say things so beautifully, Amanda.
What you said was great. Rich, do you want us to start working on that potentially at the next meeting so that we can move on with the item at hand?
We can do whatever everybody wants. I
would just say that
with that base list that I laid out.
Yeah, my only addition would be we probably ought to designate somebody to just kind of keep a rolling list that we can kind of keep track of those extension types of items that somebody's capturing that so we can keep it going forward.
Well, I will write them down right now. If we want to make, let's just make sure I've got everything. I know that we had mentioned historic cemeteries, City, Rest Haven, the St. Lovesure. Also the Macklemore House. Is the Masonic Hall going to be on this list?
I think as we look at what's been stated, and it that one kind of falls into two categories because while it was there way before the Civil War, apparently, and I've seen some of the instances where it had some significance during the Civil War, so I would say we should include it.
Oh yeah, definitely. I don't mean the question of whether or not it should be included. I want to correct myself. I mean, like, is it on in the major or like drive versus the interior core list? I think that's how I like to word it.
Oh yeah, yeah. I personally think it should be. I think it's a significant historic mile building there.
For the interior,
I think it should be part of the original core because it was Union Barracks and it was also a field hospital. So yeah, I think as
outer core list versus inner core list. Okay.
Yeah, inner core. I mean, I can't speak for Rachel, but we all have heard her plans going forward of what their plan, and it will be open and it will be much more accessible to the public.
So Rich, could you go through the items again? I want to make sure I have everything.
Carter. Carnton, Lowe's, the big three.
Okay.
Fort Granger.
Okay.
Winstead Hill. The Temple.
Okay.
And I call it the Temple because I know they're renaming it. And so we're not in a situation to where, I mean, they talked about it, the Historic Center, and Rachel did about rebranding that building. So, and then Macklemore House.
Okay, so I do have everything. I just want to make
sure. And then historic cemeteries.
Leave anything off my list.
Amanda, you're including three cemeteries, even though we only control two.
We have one parking lot for all three.
Yeah, and I don't know that, the city doesn't manage these other sites. So I do think it's important that we include the Toussaint Louverture Cemetery. It may not be a city owned site, but we do want to show people where it is and be able to allow them to know what's there and learn about it.
I just want to be sure. Thank you.
You're welcome.
My way of looking at that, Pam, has been that we have a new parking lot that's being built for certainly Rest Haven and City Cemetery. And when we talked about Hillsborough Road, we talked about it was within walking distance of the other. And so we were basically going to direct people to the parking lot and call that historic cemeteries. And then we would have some kind of graphic at that parking lot that talks about the three cemeteries and how you can get to each of them.
Right. Yeah, because you're right. With a new parking lot, they could conceivably walk across and walk up the hill to Tucson.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's just a way for us to leverage, people parking there to learn more about Tucson, which is across the street. The parking lot's only being sited there just because the land was there, and we already had access to it. It's by no means for any other reason. So,
and it's going to be over 300 spaces will be available, which is great. With a new parking lot.
No, it's like 20. Oh, yeah.
We may be talking about two different parking lots.
I'm talking about the Bicentennial Mall because that's me is juxtaposed. Mm.
Okay. There's so one under construction right now that's about 26, 27 spaces right on Hillsborough, Fifth Avenue North.
Okay.
To the cemetery.
That's really close.
But I mean, when they flush out the big parking spaces, we'll have a lot of space, obviously. And it's all walking.
Oh yeah, and people can actually park there as well and walk. So we can make sure that people are aware of Tassat and maybe partner with our Historic Cemetery Subcommittee to make sure that folks are aware that Tassat is within walking distance of these two other historic cemeteries in some meaningful way as we work on interpretation for those two sites.
Okay, that asked the question about Collins Farm.
That's a good point. I think that it's a difficult one because it's not walkable yet. And even when it will be walkable by sidewalk, it might be a little bit of a jog for most folks to walk from downtown to Collins Farm. But I do think that it perhaps could be on some of the signs that are at major intersections in downtown Franklin, especially along that area where you would need to turn onto, you know, Columbia or Lewisburg, however we decide to get people there. What do you guys think about that?
Well, would it be Collins Farm called out or part of the eastern flank?
Well, Collins Farm is very much its own site. So it is before eastern flank garden if you're driving from downtown Lewisburg south. It is a site that's a park that's owned and maintained by the city of Franklin, and we are working on a partnership with the Daughters of the American Revolution, which will have an office out there. But it is distinctive, and it's physically removed.
And there's a marker there. And Amanda, is there a bathroom facility there? I'm trying to remember. Is there a portage-on there?
There is.
Conceivably another place for people to have a bathroom. Some sort of bathroom facility available.
Do we want to consider it in our signage? It is one of the Civil War Historic Commission sites.
I would think that'd be an excellent idea if the subcommittee supported it.
I think we should. I mean, the Save the Franklin Battlefield first purchased it, and then the city purchased it from Save the Franklin Battlefield, so I think so. And hopefully there's going to be additional interpretation as the daughters take over and restoration work.
It'll be maintained as a city site, and we don't have anything formal, you know, set. That is something, a proposal that's ongoing and being worked toward, but the idea is that the daughters would like to have an office at that location and in exchange do some very much needed restoration work on the site. And it would all still be owned and maintained by the city of Franklin and have public access to, for its use as a park and in interpretive endeavors.
There's a big advantage of the fact that it is on the route. It's not a site that is off the beaten path. You know, it's right there on Lewisburg, and so I think it's fairly easy to sign our way to it or designate it as we go down toward that. So the last question that I had was, we haven't done anything haven't done anything with Forward Line. Is there a plan to do a park there?
I'm not sure I understand their question. Do you mean the Carter Hill Battlefield site?
That's no, the Forward Line down at, is it a battle?
Oh. Okay,
Columbia Battle or whatever.
I see.
It's not even a battle. I think it's
near Fairground Street, perhaps?
Fairground Street, yeah.
In Columbia, yes. I don't know that there's a plan in place for the city to own and maintain that site, no.
So that would not be something we would plan to do. It could easily be added if it's on a Columbia Avenue route, if it becomes a site.
You know, I want to say there's some signage there I remember seeing mm-hmm. not too long ago.
There's something there.
Yeah, okay.
there's a silver sign, but there's no road sign that tells you that there's that's a historic site.
Yeah, and I don't know that we would want to necessarily road signs there to direct people to a privately owned site that's not open for visitors. I think, Kelly, would you agree with that?
Okay. Yes. So,
and like Rich said, if things change over time, that's certainly something that can be added pretty easily.
Can anyone think of another site that we ought to discuss? And this is exactly what we wanted to talk about this morning, was to kind of reevaluate and solidify our mission here. Anybody got any other thoughts?
As far as the restaurant denotation, I still personally think that, as we work toward, perhaps including some proposed freestanding signs or working with DFA to, update existing merchant freestanding signs, that would be a good place to add that information. Of course, we may be able to supplement that, but I don't know if it might be something that we want to actively place on, every sign in downtown Franklin pointing to where our restrooms are.
I like the logo idea with wherever, whatever sign is pointing them into a direction or to a place. If it's got a restroom facility, public restroom facility, just using the logo, I think would be really helpful.
Yeah, and just look really discreet, but recognizable.
Yeah, I think I'd want us to do more research on that and see if there's something that is, universally recognizable for that, that would be able to be put on signage that is, what I'm gathering from you guys, vehicular signage, to so people would know. Symbology is great, but it isn't great if people don't know what that means.
We can circle back with engineering and have that conversation following this, that we know what your all's desire is to see.
Right.
Get some of their technical manuals.
Absolutely. I just want to make sure that there's something out there. Now, I'm sure there is something that could address that. I want to be more discreet about it than having a toilet fixture next to every site.
No, exactly. I get it.
If you're asking them, you might want to ask them if they know of any universally recognized visitor center sign that is the right way to head. We've always,
it was like an eye. Isn't it like a big eye that indicates information?
I think it is.
Eye or a question mark.
Yeah.
I believe it is, but we might want to ask engineering if they know.
Okay, so don't throw something at me, but while we're flushing all of this, do we need to also indicate anything that's handicap accessible? Like, for example, Fort Granger's handicap, some things are more handicap accessible than others, like Fort Granger is. Would it be important to have a key somewhere? So if you've got someone who has issues with regards to being mobile, that they would know? That they could visit these sites?
I think it's very important.
Amanda, would that be a question for engineering?
I think that I can definitely talk to them about symbology for that. And we would have to make decisions about what we would consider accessible and inaccessible. Because like Pam said, Fort Granger can be accessible, but it's not nearly as accessible as perhaps
Okay. Any other thoughts before we move on? Excellent conversation. Thank you all. And and kind of taken it from where we were the last time with the one map that I developed that we used, and I thought we used very effectively. I kind of looked at the whole inner core method of approaching things, and I developed a sign catalog, basically, that's got, we've got 26 signs that exist inside the basic historic core. And it just so happens there's 26 letters in the alphabet, so, you know, it went through A to Z. So, so we were able to, so I've identified all of those in the catalog. And if you just look quickly at the catalog that you get, you see very clearly why we are working on a universal sign look, because there are very few signs in here that look alike. It's striking how different all the wayfinding signs are. And so all these signs are now on each of the maps, not on the 96 East because we've already addressed that one, but all future maps will have every one of these signs on there when they fall in within the map. So we can kind of continue to work with that. We've also sent you two new routes. One of those routes is Lewisburg Pike, and the other one is Columbia Avenue. And they're oriented different because Columbia is, we didn't go as far into the downtown core on Columbia as we did with all the rest of the areas, and so it needed to be in a portrait type layout to make it fit. But we can, where we left the last meeting was we were working on 96 East, and we were specifically at the intersection of Church and 96. And we kind of left the meeting at that point. And at that point, we had talked about having a right turn to go to the temple, and that's designation I, that's sign I on the map. Yes, Amanda. This is the revised map that was done after the meeting with the routing that we talked about to give everybody a refresher real quick on how this map works. The red dashed line is the route that we're working with. The little arrow that you see at Eddy Lane, that's where we, when we did the outside the core, we stopped at that point. And so the red line takes us, in all cases, it's the route and it goes to the center square. And then there's a different color code for each of the different sites, but the route from off of the primary route, the red route, to the individual sites. And each one of those has got a star and the parking area is designated. So as you see, we've got the Masonic Temple and we've got two different routes to get to it. And then we led to the center square, and then heading south off the center square, we were in a direction toward the Carter House. And we talked about that we wanted to take everyone down Main Street and down to the Carter House. And then we'd peel off to go to Lotz House there, and then peel off from there and go to Carnton. And that's where we had left it the last time. We had not talked about graphics after the intersection with Church Street. I think we need to work with engineering on how to show graphics around the square. But I think we need to defer that until we're basically done with the whole conversation, because the square becomes a very critical point. And, you know, you got various routes, because you got Franklin Road coming in from the north. You've got 96 West and Hillsborough coming in from the west and northwest. And all of those eventually lead to the square. And so we kind of defer the square until the very end, and then sit in, this is my thinking, and then sit with engineering and talk about how you direct people around the square. Because there could be, you know, all eight sites somehow designated on some of the square signs. So, and I don't know how best to do that with, I think we need their expertise.
I definitely agree that we're going to need some help with that. I think that the symbology and graphics could possibly wait a little longer, but I do stand by my suggestion that perhaps we ask at least staff to weigh in with engineering after each meeting to discuss, you know, some of the routing that we have proposed at the previous meeting and get some feedback. One of the items that I did get feedback on, specific to routing, was for the green route here, as shown. And I wanted to ask everyone talk through that, because I think a lot of it, the way that we choose to route it is really depending on how we're opting to get folks to Carton from downtown. The recommendation for the route was that perhaps we ask that visitors turn left onto Fifth Avenue instead of taking them down Columbia to get to Carton. But I think that we might want to discuss, is it the intent that we take them down Columbia to Carter House and Lotes, the Carter Hill Battlefield Park Future Visitor Center there, and then, excuse me, and then on to Carton? Or is it worthwhile to consider an alternative sign to get people to Carton? Like, I want to lessen any confusion for any visitors specifically, and also our citizens, but I think it's a worthwhile conversation at this point, if Rich agrees.
I think it's an excellent point, especially if you think about the future routes. When you come in 96 West and when you come in Hillsborough and you head to Five Points, how we get to Carton should be consistent in our global planning of this. And I'm not sure that turning left onto Fifth Avenue isn't the better route to Carton. But I'm open to discussion on that.
And I'll chime for a minute, just that engineering's feedback was essentially to try to avoid a couple of sections that are more problematic. They're narrower streets, like Bulks and where South Margin come in. So they liked, because I think I recall from the previous meeting, turning left onto South Margin from Murfreesboro. So they liked pulling drivers away from that intersection.
Very much so.
The Main Street. But then they did suggest looking at Fifth Avenue Lewisburg turn from Main Street to avoid right turn movements from Folks and Stewart.
We had talked at length at the last meeting because we recognize as a subcommittee that these connectors between Columbia and Lewisburg can be difficult and more problematic in terms of the visibility, the width of the streets, what have you. So I think to Adam's point, you know, if someone is specifically looking for Carton, it may be worthwhile to consider having a sign here that would direct people that way. And then if someone's already at Carter House, we can perhaps direct them through the more minor street. But at least this would re-divert some of the potential, you know, major, you know, issue that could be driving folks from here and then to here. What's everyone's thoughts on that?
Megan, what do you think? Not to put you on the spot, but
that's fine. I don't know that I have a strong feeling either way on that one. And I'm not a road engineer, so or traffic engineer. The Fifth Avenue to Lewisburg, I mean, that I think that that's a fine route. I know that the last time we talked, though, we were concerned about that crazy intersection that you just can't avoid, you know. So I know that that's why we chose that alternative route. And I will say, I do like the idea if we're routing people, if they're coming down 96 and we're routing them to the square to get them back out to Carnton, I like the idea of them going down Columbia to pass through, to pass by Carter, Lotes, and the Franklin Battlefield Park so that they catch a glimpse of the additional history in case they were not planning on going there. So I do like that part of it. So my inclination would be to lean more towards the Columbia Avenue route. But again, traffic engineers probably have a very different reasoning behind their routes. So again, I don't really have a strong opinion either way.
Thank you for sharing that. I think that's really helpful. And to speak to this intersection a little bit, like Kelly had mentioned, it was supported by engineering to avoid having traffic on South Margin. But I do think that if it is decided to have a route go this way, it's a little safer in the sense that this is through all the way here and there's no stop sign. Maybe that's not the right way to look at that either. Maybe safer is not the right word. Maybe it's more that we don't have to worry about folks missing a turn or not being sure what to do as much so as if they were coming at the intersection from another angle. But we are looking at, as a city, on addressing that intersection. So I do want to state that publicly. We acknowledge there are some issues, and we're looking at ways to try to make that safer for everyone.
You're talking about Margin?
Yes. At that offset intersection at South Margin and Lewisburg and Fifth. Bob, do you have an opinion on it, Pam?
You know, I'm kind of like Megan, that I don't have a strong opinion one way or the other. The only thing that I think will strike a balance is, while I think it's helpful to steer people toward Main Street and the square, that, and while today in the current scenario isn't as big a deal, when traffic is going at full steam, those arteries get backed up very, very quickly. You know, you can get backed up going from church to the square, around the square, and onto Main Street. And so I think it's striking that balance between, and maybe it's a combination of letting people choose which way to go. And while I get the direction toward the square, Main Street, the visitor center, I think it can be very frustrating waiting in traffic to get through that as well.
I can appreciate that viewpoint for sure. Hopefully with the opening of Mac Hatcher, at least from the connection on the west side, some of the through traffic through downtown, simply to connect people from east to west will be eliminated to some degree. But we do want people to come downtown, and I think Bob definitely agrees with that. It's just will it cause more congestion? I think is his question.
Let's bear in mind that the route from Franklin Road coming into downtown comes down and goes through the square and then heads south out of the square toward Carnton and Carter House. And so it all passes through 5 points. And so what we're talking about is really not this specific route as much as all the routes. You get much the same thing when you come in from 96 West, although we all believe that there's less traffic that comes in Hillsborough and 96 West, that they both go through that same route as well. And so we're thinking about really all the traffic that is heading from the square from all directions heading to Carnton. So we need to kind of think more universally about that. And it's not just the specific route, but it's all the routes. I think there's a lot to be said for using Fifth Street and Lewisburg to Carnton. I think it's less circuitous, but I do like the fact that it encourages people to drive by the Carter House in the most historic part of his Civil War historic part of Franklin to get to Carnton.
The Columbia route does?
Yeah, it does.
Yeah.
Does Eric have a feeling about this?
I haven't spoken to Eric about this specifically.
He may have an opinion as to whether he would like to have all traffic routed to the new Carter House and Carter Hill and take it from there, or route around.
Well, I can certainly reach out to Eric and ask for his opinion on how he'd recommend to traffic to Carnton, whether it be more direct or via Carter House and then cut over. So I'll definitely do that.
I mean, I certainly know what Lotes would say.
Yeah, and I think that's a good point too. To Megan's point, it might introduce people to something they didn't realize was there, or since the Lotes House is on the outer core signs, that is another way to recognize it, like routing people there and then cutting over to Carnton. But keep in mind too that some people are getting, if they're going to Carnton specifically, we're catching them on the outer ring signs. We are catching them at Mac Hatcher in Lewisburg. We're catching them at Mac Hatcher and Murfreesboro Road. To ask them to turn onto Mac Hatcher and access it via Lewisburg. So they're coming up. They're coming from this direction.
And yeah. We're catching them at Franklin Road.
And we're also catching them at Franklin Road to go around. So if there is a drive specifically for folks to go to Carnton, we're likely catching them on the outer ring. And then once they're inside downtown, if they're already here for whatever reason, they're like, Carnton, I want to get to Carnton. How do I get there? Then maybe this route would be just as well. But since it was brought up by engineering, I felt like it was definitely important enough consideration to bring before you today. So I really appreciate your thoughts on that. Thank you. And I'll be in touch with Eric to ask what his thoughts are as well.
am I correct in thinking that the general consensus is we keep it as it shows on this map?
I only would throw out a question, you know, recognizing again the bigger picture of driving people toward the retail visitor center and all that, would you not have dual arrows at where, and I'm, you know, pick a spot. I know margin is not a great place to turn and coming off of that is not great, but then do you do it at church instead? And you can have an arrow that goes straight or to the left. Because if you think about if somebody's going to be on a Google Maps or Waze or something like that, it's not going to take them down Main Street to go there anyway, right?
It's not. And I do think to your point that that's why engineering feels fairly comfortable with allowing the signs to reinforce downtown. It knows, the engineering knows that it's a valuable tool for us to be able to highlight downtown and showcase some of our small businesses that may not get that exposure otherwise, because most folks are going to use other means by which to get to their destination. So the wayfinding signs are going to be helpful and definitely pull people, but maybe not to the extent that it's concerning engineering from a traffic congestion perspective.
Yeah, my only question on that was, so if I'm using Google Maps or some other navigational system to get to those places and I'm coming down 96, I guess one perspective would be it would catch you at Mac Hatcher, but another perspective would be if I'm driving toward town, the directional navigation is going to try to keep making me go left at those sites, not into downtown in the square. And do I get irritated saying, well, my navigation is telling me to go there, but the sign is saying go that way. And it's so would it be disadvantageous not to have arrows pointing both ways, straight ahead or to the left?
We could certainly ask engineering what its thoughts might be on that. I need to share a little background on Adam, just to brag on him a little bit. I didn't know this, and Kelly didn't either. When we met with him, we learned that he had coordinated the wayfinding program for the Dallas-Fort Worth Airport, which is a huge undertaking, as you can imagine. And so he's very familiar with these sorts of situations and considerations. And so I will definitely ask for his feedback on that, in terms of whether or not, you know, having one location indicated as accessible from two different directions would be supported as a wayfinding tenant or something that would be discouraged as a wayfinding tenant. And certainly explain the rationale that for which it was brought up.
Also ask him his professional opinion on dual arrows. I'd be interested in hearing the engineering side of that. I've often heard that that's a negative, that it causes confusion, you know. It tells me to go.
I think that's really the gist of my question to him will be, you know, will dual arrows, regardless of the location by which they're placed, is something that could be supported as a wayfinding tenant? And then if he has more specific questions about, well, it could work depending on the context, and I can definitely explain the context to which mm-hmm. you're referring. Because I do think
there's a lot to say about
it. It's a valid question.
Yeah. But mm-hmm. okay, good.
So he also stated, just for the record, as far as arrows go, that we could use the more traditional arrow or the crow's foot arrow. On the wayfinding signs, and I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to stop share. Just for a moment, and I'm going to pull back the sign catalog that Rich put together. This is more of a traditional arrow. When I say traditional, it's a closed-ended arrow, and you see the closed-ended arrow on this new addition to one of our newer wayfinding signs. But then there's a crow's foot arrow that you see up here, which is an open arrow. Apparently, that is a very important consideration for traffic engineering. And he just went ahead and stated that either one could be supported as long as we're consistent in how we use it. So you can see here there's inconsistency We would want to be consistent on in here as well. We'd want to be consistent on our signs as we move forward. So that might be something we want to think about as we get more in the macro, or I'm sorry, micro type details on you know, how the signs would look.
Amanda, did he say which one is recommended?
Kelly, I'm not sure I recall him saying one way or the other if there's a recommendation.
I was just curious.
I recall him saying that at one point the crow's feet arrows weren't allowed, but they were a more recent allowable arrow type, so now they are allowed. But I think traditionally the other arrow type has been more longstanding.
And he did say, for the record, that the Dallas-Fort Worth Wayfinding Program did choose to use the crowsbud arrow. So that's why he had to seek approval specifically for that, because as Kelly noted, they were not supported originally, but now they are more universally supported.
Thank you.
I think we can go either way. It's just more of an aesthetic choice, perhaps. Or we can do a little more research to understand why they weren't supported and kind of weigh into that as well. Perhaps what's easier for our sign shop to make, if there is, you know, if it's cheaper to make one or the other. I mean, I know that sounds silly, but we're making, you know, we're proposing a lot of signs, and over time that could be a cost measure. And so little things like that can make a difference.
Certainly.
All right, Rich, do you, I know we only, unfortunately, we only have a few minutes left. We did a lot of really good work on goals today, so we didn't get as much into the map as we planned. Do you want me to pull the map back up, or is there anything else you want to discuss?
Yeah, if you will, please.
Okay, definitely.
I think we've accomplished a lot today. And I don't see that we're recommending any changes off of this map at this point.
No, I don't think so.
And what I would suggest for the next meeting is to move on and talk about Columbia Avenue and Lewisburg jointly, because they're very closely related. If you come in Lewisburg or you come in Columbia, it all bottles into a very narrow area. And so that's, and maybe we talk about routes before we talk about signs specifically for all of this, because the signs start to get to where we're putting the same stuff on the same on signs everywhere and that type of thing. But we kind of, my thinking here recently, and I'm open to suggestions on this, is to where we kind of, we go through a process of discussing each route and the right ways that we want to do it. And then we universally, and then we globally kind of look at the signs that are involved after we've discussed and come to some conclusions on each of the routes and that, and then come up with signs, because it's really a very small geographic area and not as many signs as we probably think there will be. And so all the signs will have a lot of different things on them. And so is everybody in agreement on that?
Did I accidentally share a different screen?
No, you're good.
Okay, I'm sorry.
We lost Pam, I guess. Is Pam still here?
No, I don't think so. I wasn't aware that she dropped off because I'm sharing screen and I can't see everybody.
Mm-hmm. How do we end?
Well, we have to end.
We'll still go ahead and take a vote.
Yeah, it'll be fine. But I think she was here until fairly recently. Unfortunately, I can't confirm that because I wasn't able to watch that. So Well, we'll go ahead and move forward. Rich, did you have any additional thoughts before we adjourn? Or does anyone else have anything you want to share before we adjourn? I want to thank you all for all your work today. I think that the refresher on the goals has been really helpful, especially for me, and thinking through outer core versus inner core, as you know, the language by which we're speaking for, you know, attracting folks in, and then trying to manage more of the micro scale in the downtown core. And then having that thorough list has been really helpful for me. And then knowing that, well, there she is.
She's and back.
She was just having some trouble there. Having, you know, maybe some knowledge that perhaps our Board of Mayor and Aldermen might like to add some additional things. Just knowing that that's a possibility, and planning ahead to know that we might at certain locations need to accommodate those on the signs as we design those will be really helpful.
Great. Any other discussion before we adjourn? Seeing no one. Let me find my papers here. I will take a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second?
Bob.
Second.
Megan? Steve is absent. Rachel is absent. Pam?
Yes.
Thank you. Mary is absent. Bob?
Yes.
Megan?
Yes.
And I vote yes. Okay. Thank you all. Great meeting.